He has completed our BHMS degree from and present now he is doing a master's. And before joining to the master, he has been to Mumbai to directly from Dr. Prabhu Vijayakar. He is fixer degree. He has been a very promising homeopathic student. And since last 2 years, he has been practicing we are very happy that he has agreed to share our experiences. So, Dr. Swati, you can start.
ಸರ್ 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 ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ ಹೇಳಿ ಸರ್. ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಭಾರತಿ ಅವರು ಮೈಕ್ ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ ಹೇಳಿ ಸರ್.
ನಾನೇ ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ನೀವು ಅನ್ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿ ಸರ್.
ಹಾ ಸರ್, ಗುಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ನೂನ್. ಲೈಕ್ ಸರ್ ಸೇಡ್, ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಬೀನ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ 2 years ಸಿನ್ಸ್ ಐ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಮೈ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟಿಸ್, ಅಂಡ್ ಟುಡೇ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಶೇರಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಫ್ಯೂ ಕೇಸಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಮೈ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟಿಸ್. ಎಮ್ ಐ ಆಡಿಬಲ್?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so we'll start with the first case. So this was a case which was referred to me by a senior practitioner from Bombay. They were earlier taking treatment from him in Bombay, and recently they had, around the time when they had come to visit me for consultation, just a few months before they had shifted to Bangalore. So they wanted continuation along the same line. So this is a 9-year-old girl. She's in 4th standard, and she's been diagnosed with alopecia since the age of 4 years. In the beginning, it was alopecia universalis, means even the eyebrows, there was no hair. So then they started, they went to the dermat, and they were given some ointment, and she regained all her hair within 15 days. But again, within 1 month, she lost the hair. So that's when she started consulting the homeopath in Bombay. And he had given her some medicine with which there was a lot of improvement. Like the eyebrow hair had come back, and even the scalp hair, it started forming again. And for quite some time, she was okay. But again, she started developing some patches. Mainly the patches were on along the frontal hairline and along the occiput. And what they observed is that when the frontal hair patches would be filling, then their occipital hair patch will become worse. And if the occipital hair patch is filling, then the frontal hair patches would become worse. So that was around the time when she had come to my clinic. So if you can appreciate, these are the patches on the frontal hair. On the, towards the sides it is. So when she had come to me, the frontal hair patches were slightly better, but the occipital hair area, the patch was really bad. You can see from the image, this is the occipital region. Images are not visible.
Visible, visible.
Yeah, along with the
visible.
Yeah, along with the alopecia, she also had recurrent colds, runny nose, sneezing, especially aggravated after swimming, and she also had urticaria. And urticaria has been there since quite many years. Yearly once she used to get very severe episode. Especially during rains, and she has to take some anti-allergic medicine, otherwise it would not subside by itself. There was no significant past history and no significant family history. Personal history, appetite was good. She likes non-veg food, can tolerate hunger. She preferred warm food, and like most of the children these days, she prefers a lot of junk food, pizzas, burgers, fries, etc. And aversion to vegetables. She's thirstless, chilly. There was no significant finding in sleep, no significant finding in urine and bowels. Perspiration was more on forehead region, and physical sensitivity, she had startling from noise. Coming to the mind, there are four people staying at home. Basically, they're from North India, and her father's both the parents are working, and father's an engineer, and yeah, so it's just the four of them who are at home. This is the most of the history I got is from her mother. So her mother describes her as a very sentimental child. She's very attached to her mother. She likes art. She likes playing with friends, outdoor games. Yes, Dr. Bharat has raised his hand. Any question? Yes, Dr. Bharati. Yeah. Any question is there, doctor?
I think you can carry on.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. When I tried to interact a little bit with the child, and what I found was she's not very expressive. Like whatever question I ask, it would be either a one word answer or she would require a lot of prompting. So I tried to make a little small talk, and this is all she described. She says that she keeps making and losing friends, and yeah, not many friends. She's more of a reserved, silent person. This one incident her mother has narrated, like in her apartment. There are a group of children with whom she goes for playing. So in that, one girl is very bossy. But everybody else listens to that bossy one except her. But this girl does not react also. The only thing is that she doesn't follow whatever she says. And she gets angry when others follow what that girl dictates them. So her mother says that she's somebody who will not blindly follow just for the sake of following. Like she has a mind of her own. She's not somebody who will directly rebel, but she decides she'll do what she wants to. And yeah, she's attached only to one friend. According to mother, she starts crying for small things. Like even if spoken to harshly, she'll start crying. But outside, she holds herself very well. So what the mother was trying to say was at home, she's okay with showing off her weakness. Like she cries for small things and all that. But outside, she's someone who will hold back her emotions. She's not expressive of her emotions. So at school, she's very calm, composed, a very good girl image she has at school. There are no complaints from teachers. Everybody finds her a very well-mannered child. And at school, according to her, she has a lot of friends, and there are no problems as such at school. Again, her mother describes her. She's very timid by nature. Takes time to mingle with new people to get comfortable. According to the mother, she's not very studious or intelligent, but she does her homework by herself. And she's very image conscious at school. I asked her as to why the consciousness and all. So she says that she doesn't want anybody to scold her or criticize her. They should not point out anything against her. That is why she tries to maintain a very clean image at school. Like she'll finish all her work on time and, you know, well behaved. And yeah, I tried asking her if she has any hobbies or she participates in any extracurricular activities. So she says she's very afraid of solo performances because she's afraid that she might make a mistake and then she'll get criticized or people will speak rudely to her. Yeah. So she has a sister. A younger sister, she's just 3 years old. So I asked her mother, how is this girl different from her sister? So her mother says that the younger one is more assertive. Like if she wants something, she wants it at any cost and she'll make sure she gets it. And the younger one is very chalu. Chalu means very cunning and can get things done her way. Younger one does not compromise. But this patient, the girl who has alopecia, she's not like that. She's not very assertive, and she's the one who will compromise easily. Yeah. So her mother's a teacher. She had taken a break from work for 3 years, until the patient turned 3 years old. So the mother says that she was cared for by grandparents and she was put at a daycare, but she could not adjust. This girl could not adjust. So this question came up because I was trying to find out as to if there was any stress or any major life-changing incidents around the age of 3 or 4 years, because that's when she started developing alopecia. according to mother, apart from this, there is no significant history. She says that the only change in her life was that mother started going to work and she was not able to adjust. She used to cry a lot. And even now, from then also, and even now also, she would keep going towards her parents and she'd try to hug them and everything. But the younger sister, she keeps trying to push her away. And she'll tell her that they are my parents and all. Then this girl, she starts crying and she has to be consoled. She's a child, it's okay and all. Yeah. Anger is expressed at home. She's most of the time she's irritable after school. And she always keeps complaining that the mother only keeps scolding all the time. And she weeps easily, but only at home, and wants consolation only from parents. She is very good at art and crafts and she enjoys art and crafts. And she's a very disciplined child. Like whatever the parents tell, she'll listen to them. She's not very stubborn or tantrum throwing child. Memory is good, not very talkative, and she'll do household work to make her mother happy. Yeah. She misses the attention from parents. That's what the mother was trying to tell me. And earlier, she used to peel skin and she had a habit of biting nails. And she cannot wear synthetic clothes. She prefers cotton clothes, soft clothes. Like if she wears synthetic clothes, she starts feeling some sort of irritation. And about her alopecia, I asked her, like, how is her reaction to it? So she says that she tries to cover her patches. And a couple of times she's asked her mother if she can get her entire head shaved. She used to feel that if she gets her head shaved, maybe then she'll develop good hair. And mother also tells that she's got a very strong sense of right and wrong. Means easily she won't get influenced by whatever other children are telling or whatever other children are doing. She's not someone who will blindly follow or just get influenced. Yeah. And this one point that kept coming up throughout the history, she restrains her emotions a lot, especially when she's outside. She doesn't really show what is going on in her mind. So her mother gave an example. Recently, she won a prize for a painting and she was getting a lot of appreciation for some national level painting competition. So everybody, she was very happy, but she's not expressing it. Even the teacher had to actually tell her that, you know, you can smile. So she's that kind of a child, like even happiness, sadness, anger, let it be any emotion, she tries to restrain herself. She doesn't express at all. And her mother is quite strict. According to mother, she's not very organized. Like she has to keep telling her to take medicines or whatever. So the mother keeps scolding her. But as such, she's very close to mother and shares everything with her mother. Yeah. So that is all about the case. Any inputs from your side? Like how do we solve this case? The case is clear. Yeah, want of attention, Sushma. What else? Yeah, sensitive to reprimand, sensitive to criticism.
Injustice cannot support.
Injustice cannot support. What would be the reason for that? Like choosing injustice cannot support?
Because she was, what do you say, the girl named Dia, she was trying to control her. But she came to know that it's not right. She stepped back.
Yeah.
So I think she is not, what to say, she cannot see injustice.
More than injustice, she's not somebody who likes to be bossed around by people. Like she feels that everybody should have an equal. It was not exactly injustice as such. It's just that the girl was very dominating. And all the other kids, she would dominate. And this girl, she doesn't like following just for the sake of following. But she used to not rebel or anything. She used to not like that, but she won't talk back. But she would do what she wants to do. Yeah, she's quite mature for her age. Yeah, she's conscientious, Amida. What could be the rubrics for this case? Or In such cases, what should be our approach? Yeah, she's that one thing I also noted, she's quite mature for her age. Even in my clinic also when they had visited, she was the one who was taking care of her sister. Actually, the history that I have taken, right? Yeah, we should look for syphilitic rubrics, Dr. Sophia. This is a case of, autoimmune condition. So we should look for syphilitic rubrics. Cannot tolerate contradiction. Okay. Yeah. So initially when, responsibility stopped. Initially when she had come to me, I did not give her any medicine because I had spoken to the homeopath who referred the case to me. So he told me that as of now, the patches are filling. So you just take a call and according to your judgment, you can, cannot smile. Dr. Sophia, what could be the rubric for that? Cannot smile. Because, that was my entry point for this case. So this was what I noted. See, 4 visits, I had not prescribed anything. She was only on PL for the 4 visits because there was no deterioration. And I was told that her follicles are, her patches are better. But in the 4th visit, the occiput patch became worse. It started becoming worse. So that's when I decided, okay, I need to medicate. So from my 4 visits, I had observed that she was someone who was always serious. First visit, we can expect the child is timid or shy and she might not want to be so expressive. But even after 4 visits, she was not very comfortable. She would hardly smile. She would just sit there. Yeah, smiles never, Dikshit. And she'll speak only when spoken to and very well behaved, very properly behaved. And she would take care of her younger sister. So I took 3 rubrics. Hair affections off in general, periodicity annually, and laughing never. Like that smiles never, I have taken this rubric. Instead of smiling never, I have taken laughing never. Periodicity annual I have taken because her urticaria was of annual recurrence. Every year around the same time, she would get a very severe episode. And hair affections off in general, I have taken just to see if my remedy is covering. Even though there is a direct rubric alopecia, I chose to take this rubric. And any guesses as to what remedy you could prescribe? 3 remedies are coming up, ammonium carb, arsenic and sulfur. Yeah, I have prescribed Nutramas. Dr. Manjunath has answered, yeah. Sushma, arsenic, yeah. I have prescribed Nutramas because like I described, she's a very mature child, like too mature for her age and too well-behaved and all. So that element of Nutram I felt is more strong in her. So I have given her Nutramas. So in February 2018, I've given her Nutramas. She had come to my clinic in September 2017. And from September to February, she was only on PL. February, I had given her Nutramas 201 dose. And in May, she had urticaria, mild urticaria. Every year she used to get very severe episode, but this time it was a milder episode. She had to be given medication, but not as much as previous times. And like I said, in the 4th visit, there was a new patch. This time I asked if there were any new patches. There was no new patch. And we started noting some growth in the hair follicles in all the 3 patches. But the occiput region patches, they started filling first. Frontal region patches, they were filling slowly only. And in August, again, they had come. Again, there was a lot of progress. And forehead, not much of improvement, but patch on occiput is filling. And in January 2019, again, I had to repeat one dose because they said there was no significant difference between previous and current visit. And by August 2019, her patches were much better. She had very mild episode. 2018, one episode of urticaria. 2019, again, one episode of urticaria, but very mild episode, and this time she did not require even Atarax or Allegra, even a single medication she did not require. There was not much of itching also. So again, I have just prescribed PL. And she used to get episodes of cold, recurrent cold. That was that also they told that episodes have reduced and are of manageable intensity. So these are the pictures on taken in August 2019. This is a patch on Oxyquit. Forehead also there is. Yeah, forehead, the follicle started coming, but yeah. Generally, she has very thin hair. And yeah, we stopped her medication on December 2019. And as of now, she's perfectly fine. There has been no regression. Like earlier, I said, right, if occipital region, if the patches are filling in frontal region, it will start getting worse. So that regression has not happened. It has been constantly consistent. Like the growth has been consistent. And because I was taking this webinar, I recently just checked with her mother. And her mother says, as of now, there has been no complaints as such. Like the hair fall has been stopped and the hair growth is consistent. First case, any doubts in the first case? Yeah, I think we can start with the next one. This is again a pediatric case. It's a case of Watts. He's an 8-year-old boy. He's studying third standard. They came to me in May 2018. There was a cauliflower-like wart growth on the left thumb, and that they have noted since 2 to 3 months. And I have never seen this kind of eruption. So initially, even I was confused as to whether I would be able to treat it or not. And yeah, are you able to see the image? I mean, the images are visible, right? Dr. Guru Kiran says it's not.
Yes,
visible.
Yes, it is,
yeah.
Visible.
Yeah. Okay. So this is how it looked when they had first come. And frankly speaking, I had no confidence. I didn't know because anything that is, I mean, I had no idea if I would be able to treat this case or not. So I looked for the direct rubric, what on thumb. There was only one rare medicine which I've never heard of and which is not available in my career. So I took the child's case in detail. Past history, recurrent cold and cough and recurrent CSON. More of left-sided ear infections and past history of recurrent tonsillitis. That's all in past history. Family history, nothing significant. Personal history, hunger is good, can tolerate hunger, does not eat vegetables much. Desire for potato, paneer and sweets. Say, their family, everybody eats non-veg, but this child, he did not like non-veg right from the beginning. He can't even... He's never tried it, but he doesn't like it at all. So it's a strong aversion to non-veg since beginning. And he's thirsty. Perspiration, more on palms and soles. Slightly offensive on soles. And he finds it very difficult to run. Thermals, hot. Urine and bowels, nothing significant. Sleep, earlier he would, his sleep would get disturbed by slightest noise. Now he has a sound sleep. No significant dreams. Coming to mental symptoms, at home there are 4 people, parents, and he has an elder sister. And he studies every day and he's quite diligent, but according to him, he's not as studious as his sister, but he's very good at studies. Recently, he had won a gold medal at Maths Olympiad. His mother says that he's very naughty. Teachers complain that he finishes his work fast and he starts disturbing other children. He keeps talking and moving around in the class. And his mother says that he's very restless. In my clinic also, he kept moving from one place to another, like inside my chamber, and then he would start going out to the waiting area, and then again he would come back. And he enjoys games that involve a lot of running around, jumping, he doesn't like indoor games or, you know, those board games in which you have to just sit at one place. And yeah, he has a lot of friends. He mixes easily with new people, makes friends easily. His mother says he likes to be friendly with people who are more studious, more intelligent than him. That kind of children he likes befriending. And he wants to become a footballer. As compared to his sister, he's more stubborn, but they can convince him. His favorite subject is maths. He participates in all activities. And he has to be told a lot. Like, if they want to get any work done, they have to keep requesting him again and again. But eventually he'll do it. And yeah, he wants to keep doing something or the other. He's not a child who likes to sit idle. Some or the other thing he has to keep doing. And his grasping is very good. He likes learning new things. One more thing that his mother told, if someone else is doing something better than him, he feels bad. He'll cry and he's very competitive, and until he gets better than them, he'll not feel he'll not feel at peace. And what I observed was he asked a lot of questions. He's very curious about everything. Like in my clinic also, he kept moving from one place to another. All the whatever instruments are there, he kept asking me how to operate and what is it for. And when I confirmed with the mother, she also said that at home also he's like that, or wherever he goes, generally he's very curious. He wants to know the how and why of things. Yeah. So, what could be your analysis for this case? Maths aptitude for inquisitive. Anjanath. Yeah, Pragati, inquisitive. Restlessness, children. Jealous. Yeah. Restlessness in children. So, yeah, industrious, Shweta. Mind busy, Dr. Harsha, mind busy. Dr. Deepa, competitive. Yeah. So I took the rubric, I took comprehension easy because his grasping was very fast and inquisitive, like many of you have suggested. I've taken food and drinks, meat aversion, because his entire family is very fond of non-veg. He's someone who's never tried also. And right from the beginning, he has a strong dislike for it. And the last rubric that I took was perspiration general and palm. So three remedies, calcarea, lyco, and sulfur. What could be the remedy that... Sulfur, okay. Dr. Deepa, sulfur. Thermals, he's hot. He's a hot patient. Dr. Dikshit, lyco. Yeah. I gave him lyco. I gave him one dose of lyco. After lyco, he did not come back. They did not come back for quite some time. So I thought maybe it has not improved and they would have gotten it cauterized. But in August, his sister had, they had come to consult for his sister. And that's when I asked about this boy, and they told that. And I was also very curious because if you observe the growth, I didn't know like if it is going to start shrinking or it's just going to fall off. I was really curious about this case. And when I asked the mother, she told that May he had come, right? So in July, they had gone home for summer vacations. And when he was playing, it suddenly just fell off. The whole ward fell off from his thumb. So if you can appreciate the image, it was on his left thumb here. Yeah, so we'll move on to the next case. Okay. So this is actually one of my neighbors, this patient. She used to have recurrent respiratory tract infections. And in January 2019, that is last year, she had come to me during an acute episode of cold. So she has frequent cold, sinusitis, cough. Every alternate month she used to get, and this has been happening since 2 years. And every episode is very severe, like she would not recover for almost 10 to 12 days. And this particular time, she has come with cough associated with breathlessness. I mean, she told that she felt a wheeze. And when she's inspiring, she feels that there is dryness of the nasal cavity. And her complaints are more towards the evening. And during each of these episodes, she feels very tired and very weak. Yeah. Actually, she's my neighbor, so I was not able to ask her a lot of questions or whatever, because our history taking is a little lengthy. So from whatever little history I could manage, I had to just stick to more or less her presenting complaints or health-related history. So, yeah. So when I asked her since when she has these complaints, she says that since last 8 years, she's having these recurrent episodes. Until 8 years ago, she had absolutely no health issues. So what happened 8 years back was her father was not keeping well, and he was hospitalized. And around that time, she developed pneumonia. It was the first episode of pneumonia. And she says that since then, her health has gone down. And in the last 8 years, she's got pneumonia twice. I asked her which side. She was not able to tell that correctly. Yeah. This was the only, this was the only trigger. That's what she says for her complaints. And during these episodes, she feels more thirsty and she prefers to drink warm water. Actually, she likes cold water, ice cold water. But because of her illness, she has started avoiding. She loves ice creams, but this is what she told me, that she stopped eating ice creams out of fear because she doesn't know what could trigger her cold. Every alternate month, she would start having very bad episodes of cold. And she said, because of these regular episodes of cold, she's not able to do her office work properly. And she's feeling very guilty that she's not giving proper attention to her work. And because of the headaches, cough and cold, her sleep gets disturbed and there is a lot of pain in the chest region. She's a workaholic. She's into software designing. They are my opposite house neighbors, so a little idea about her I already had. Her husband manages a small business from home. So in their house, he stays at home and he manages the household, and they have one daughter. So he takes care of her while she's the one who's going for work. And he has a business from home, and they have had this arrangement right from the beginning, and there are absolutely no issues at home. Work-wise, currently, she's in the midst of a job crossover. Means recently she quit her job and she's been looking for a new one. So I asked her if she's got any kind of stress or anything. So she says that even at present, when because husband is at home and she also has no job, even at present when there is no financial security, she's someone who has a very positive outlook. Not just for in this situation, in general also, she's someone who's quite positive. And from the way she spoke also, you can make out that she's someone who's got a lot of grace and very positive speaking. And she's a planner, very organized, very meticulous, wants things to be in order. Thermally, she's chilly. So because she's my neighbor, I couldn't really get a lot of history from her. And when she had come, it was a little bad episode. So from this much history, what could be your analysis? I mean, can we prescribe positive? Yes, Dr. Manohar. What else? Anxiety concerns of industrious, positive. Okay. What else? Anything else? Anything else that is significant in this history? Workaholic desires ice cold. Anything else? What could be the possible remedies? Plans making Dr. Manjunath, yeah, Shweta Arsenic, Dr. Sufia Phosphorus. Being neighbor, you cannot ask for please. Manoha sir. No. I am generally a very hesitant person. I did not ask for please, but she gave please and she went. Anything particular in character of Kauf? No. Nothing particular in character of Kauf. Started after her father's illness. So anything related to that? Yeah, all her complaints started after that. And when he was hospitalized, she got pneumonia. And after that, her father passed away also. As of now, nothing, no other stressor. She misses her father, but she says that she has accepted it. So there's no stress related to that. Yeah, she's very responsible. Okay, in this case, developed complaints after father fell ill. We can consider this, but it's already been 8 years. So I didn't really give that much importance to ailments from. But in this case, what she has told, like if you observe, she said until she developed pneumonia, she was absolutely in the best of health. After pneumonia, she started convalescence ailments during lungs after inflammation. Yeah, I took a similar rubric because we have read in our textbooks, in our Materia Medica, never well since pneumonia. I was looking for something like that. I also did not know that there would be a rubric. I was just trying to find out. And this is the rubric that I found in Murphy Repertory in diseases chapter, convalescence. Ailments during or since pneumonia after. Consciousness, conscientiousness about refills and positiveness. These three rubrics I have taken and I had prescribed ours, like many of you had guessed. Yeah. So arsenical 200, one dose I had given in January last year. And after 3 days I had asked her to come and she was better by 99%. So I had continued with SL. And after that in February, she had slight itchiness in throat, but this time she said the cold did not progress and it was manageable. So again, I had given her SL only. So she was fine. For many months, she was absolutely fine. Again, in June, she came back. She said there were no episodes of cold since February. But again, in June, since 2 days, she developed some mild throat irritation, which was better by drinking water, warm water. So again, because it was not affecting her genitals or her episode, it was not as severe as her previous episodes, I just gave her SL. And in October, she came back so from June to October, no episodes of cold. October, again, she felt some tiredness, heaviness, again, pain in the occipital region, not able to eat. So this time, because she looked her genitals were affected, so I had prescribed ourselves 1M. And yeah, in February, she came again. She said she's been absolutely fine. No episodes of cough, cold, headaches. See, earlier, she used to get every alternate month very bad episodes. The last 1 year, maybe 2 episodes, that too very mild she had got. And in the first, when she had come to me initially, she told that she had stopped eating ice creams and cold drinks and all. So in February, when she came in 2020, she told that she's now able to eat ice creams and cold drinks and she's not falling sick or anything else. So that was with single dose of arsenic. I was really scared to take this case because it's my neighbor. It was like a make or break situation for me. But luckily, she got better and now she refers a lot of patients now. This is another case of renal stones. This is a recent case. He's a 34-year-old man. He's working in government sector. He came to me in June 2019 with severe pain in the left loin region since 3 days. And the pain is associated with shifting pain in abdomen with sensation as if abdomen was blocked. He's again a North Indian and he said, "Ki pet mein sab jama hua hai." That was his exact line. And his appetite is decreased. He also complained of bitter taste in mouth and weakness and difficulty in passing stools. So when he came to me, he had already, by then he had already gone to the allopath, taken painkillers and everything. And he said with painkillers, slightly the pain had come to control, but he was not feeling better still. So someone in his native had suggested that homeopathy has good remedies, and he actually came with the names of remedies which he wanted. He took some, he told Berberis and Lycopodium, couple of remedies which someone had suggested to him. So his wife and his son are my patients. So I told him that I do not prescribe like that. And there was no history of nausea, vomiting, dysuria, oliguria, hematuria, and absolutely no abnormal findings in physical examination. And when he had come to me, he had already gotten a UST done. And UST, there was only mild left hydroneutral nephrosis. But no renal stone was not present in the USG finding. So he had gotten a CT done, CT scan. And in the CT, CT showed a mild left hydroureteral nephrosis due to calculus in the distal ureter, 10 millimeter proximal to the vesicoureteric junction. And these are the measurements, 6 into 4.5 into 9 millimeters. Yeah, there were two stones. Both were in the left kidney region only. One was of this dimension, 6 into 4.5 into 9, and the other stone was 2 millimeter. So this was his CT scan, dated 22nd June. Okay, so kidney stones up to what measurement can go spontaneously only by drinking water? Yeah, up to 5 mm can go spontaneously without medication just by drinking water. And up to 7 millimeter kidney stones, they will require some medicinal intervention. Okay, no need of surgery, but some medicine is required. Or sometimes, very rarely, it can pass even spontaneously without any medication. But if it is a stone above 7 millimeter, usually they suggest for surgical intervention. They say it does not go even with medicine. So when he had come to me, because he used to come for his wife and his son, I already had a little idea about his basic nature. So based on that, and actually when he had come, his condition was very bad. He was in severe pain, was not in a state to talk or give history. And he was very restless, and his wife told that throughout the night, he kept tossing and turning, and he kept expressing a feeling of hopelessness because of the pain. And he was not able to bear any touch on the abdomen also. So I tried to take, even if I wanted to take history, he was not in a state to give any history. So what could be our approach in this condition, in this case? Yeah, pain shifting, left-sided renal affection, Dr. Sufla. Despair due to pain. Particular entry points, despair pain from. Yeah, so actually what mistake I did was, because I, his wife had mentioned that he has a tendency to renal stones, like earlier also he has got. So I thought if it is a recurrent condition, we should give a constitutional prescription. And based on the my idea about his constitution from his previous visits, I gave him calcareous salve 200. Okay. But in spite of that, there was no change. So because it was such a severe pain, I had asked him to get back either on phone or visit me within a day or two. So he had called up and he said that his condition continues to remain the same. In fact, the pain had become much worse. So then I had repertorized. I took the presenting totality. So this was my totality. Despair, pains with, mind, anguish, pain from abdomen in, kidney stones, and general side loss. So two remedies were coming, calcarea and lachesis. Now calcarea I've already prescribed and there was no change. But since he already mentioned about sensitivity on abdomen, I gave him lachesis. So lachesis 200, one dose I had given. Yeah, on 22nd June, I had given him lachesis 200, one dose. And 23rd, he called back. He said his pain is much better and he was able to sleep. Even the restlessness and tossing about was much better. His appetite improved considerably. He was able to pass stool and his weakness was better. So I continued with PL and I then asked him to come back after 3 days. And he said now, after 3 days, he said completely the pain is gone and his general condition also was fine. So I continued with PL again. So on 1st July, he said that he experienced a mild pain and heaviness in left region while passing urine. And that pain lasted for a few seconds. And then he said he felt he heard a clicking sound and he felt that the stone has passed off. Overall, he's better. And I continued with PL. And 13 July, again, he came back. He said the last 13 days has been completely fine. There are no complaints at all. So I told him to repeat ultrasound, but he never repeated it. He said he felt better, so he decided it's not required. So he didn't come back after for quite some time. Then again, in November, he came. This time he presented with severe pain in right lumbar region, radiating to right hypochondriac region. This is since 2 days. There were no associated complaints. And I knew it would be a stone because he has a tendency. So he got a USG done. And this time it revealed a right-sided hydroureteronephrosis, secondary to a distal ureteric calculus, measuring around 7 millimeters in size. And this stone also was, the size of the stone also was not something that could pass off spontaneously with just by drinking water. And his left kidney was absolutely fine. Last time the complaints were in left kidney and left ureter. That was absolutely fine. So getting the complaint again, even after medication, what does it suggest? What could be, and this time the site has also changed. So what could be your interpretation? Yeah, suppression. Yeah, so actually when I had prescribed to him lachesis, right, I had told him that time itself, when he got better also, that because I prescribed for his present state, it will not be helpful for him to prevent stone formation again. I had already informed him and I told him that he needs to come back and give a detailed history so that I can give him a remedy to remove the tendency. But since he was better and at that time there was no pain or anything, he decided that it's okay. So this time when he came, yeah, this is the reading, the report from November 2019, right-sided hydroureteronephrosis secondary to distal ureteric calculus. So this time, since the pain was not so severe, he was fine. So I told him that I'll have to take your detailed history and I decided to prescribe constitution because this time the pain was manageable. So he has a past history of recurring urolithiasis since 2016. For which he has undergone lithotripsy. This again, he says, since 2016, once or twice in a year, he has this renal stone complaint. Family history, mother has cholelithiasis and bronchial asthma, otherwise no complaints as such. Physical genders, he prefers warm food and fresh food. Food has to be fresh always. And he likes eggs and rice. First, he says he has increased his water intake, because obviously since 2016 he's been getting recurrent stones, so almost every doctor would have advised him to drink more water. Bowels, nothing as such. Bladder, no complaints. Perspiration, it is more on the neck region. Sleep is alert, disturbed by slightest noise. Normally he is a hot patient. Tight clothing he cannot bear, he dislikes, he gets suffocation. This is since childhood. And noise also he cannot bear, it irritates. He says his BP starts rising. If a lot of people come together and they start talking a lot, he feels very irritated. So he does not like going to movies or in theaters because of the noise. Coming to mind, so at home it is just his wife, son and himself. He's in Bangalore since 10 years. He's basically from Bihar. Last 3 to 4 years, because he has recurrent renal stones, I tried asking him if he had any financial or any territory or property related issues or anything. So he told me that there is nothing as such. Financially he's fine and there are no property issues or anything. The only stress that has been there is that his wife has been having health issues since last 3-4 years. So since his child is still small, he was worried that because wife is not well, would everything be fine? Even when I go to work, my mind would be at home. Actually, the wife did not have any major health issues. It was just a recurrent gastric complaints. But he says apart from that, there was no stress as such. Another thing that he says is, he's been trying to go back home to Bihar. He does not want to stay in Bangalore. He's working in government sector. He's been trying to get a transfer back to Bihar, but it is not happening. So I asked him why he wants to go back. So he says that parents are old and I have to take care of them. Presently, my father is still working, but in the long run, I should be the one who should go back and who should take care of them. So I'm trying to get a transfer. And I show a lot of sympathy. I keep others' needs as a priority. As far as possible, I help. So I asked him why he's so helpful and why he tries to help others. So he says that up to 14th year, he was brought up with by his maternal grandparents because his mother was not well. So there, the atmosphere was like that. Everybody is caring, looking after one another. Everybody is very helpful. So only I've developed this nature. So I asked him, okay, what kind of help do you do? Like, can you give me some examples? So he says, like if any bachelor friend is there, I would invite him. I would offer lunch. Then I have helped people financially also. So when I asked him if he expects that they should return the money, he says that, see, when I help, no, I don't expect that they should give me back money or they should do the same thing for me. But whatever help I have given, they should remember that. What has happened with me is, in terms of behavior, I don't get the same treatment as I give. Like I treat people so nicely, I don't get the same treatment back. That is my only problem, is what he said. So I asked him what happened, or give me some examples. So he gave a couple of examples. He says, he's working for government sector. They stay in government quarters. So one of his neighbor, who is his colleague also, he's a bachelor. They were very close. They had a very good bonding. And initially to office and all, because that other, his colleague did not have personal transportation, he used to take him along with him in office. So he says, what happened is he started changing after he got married. When he got married, after marriage, he got his first bike. He did not even invite me. So they kept some puja or something for the wife. And that colleague invited all of their neighbors, all of their friends. But this person was not invited. He was like, he should have told me first, but he called everyone else and except me. I felt he's so selfish. Maybe he's influenced by his wife. Whenever some third person enters, then only people start changing. Maybe his wife did not want us in their life. Since he got married, our relation has got cut. He slowly started maintaining a distance. he has created such an atmosphere that I myself should withdraw. Means that colleague has directly not said anything, but he feels that indirectly he has started creating an atmosphere by which these people only should go back. So I asked, what did you feel? And he's like, I have done so much for him. I felt very bad. I felt very hurt because he was a bachelor. Every day I used to call him home for lunch, dinner. All his meals were at my house. Every day I used to take him to office and all. Before marriage, he was so close to me. I have done so much for him. And now he has started withdrawing. I feel very bad. I feel very hurt. I still talk to him. I've been hurt emotionally, but I don't bear any grudge or hatred. I just feel hurt. I feel it should not have happened. Then he gave another example. Similar incidents has happened with another person, like his cousin. He's come from Bihar. When he came to Bangalore, I have supported him a lot. Now he has got settled. Initially, when he was searching for a job, when he was searching for a house and everything, this patient only had helped him settle down, like in help, finding a job, finding a house and everything. I have considered him more than myself. उसको मैंने अपने अपने फैमिली से भी ज्यादा समझा. But now after settling, he does not share anything. About his salary also, he has not told me. And his marriage also got settled. He didn't tell me. Just 2 or 3 days before the marriage, he has informed me. Everything I get to know at the end. I feel like he has not given me the value or the respect that I deserve. Both these people, means his friend and his cousin, both these people have used and thrown me. So then I asked him, okay, these people have done like this. What is your reaction? Are you still in touch with them? So he says, yeah, I'm still in touch with them. I talk to them and I don't have any hurt or any hatred for them. Even now, when they need any help, I will forget all the old things and I'll go and help them. I can't bear to see them in pain. I never confront them. I feel that. Then I asked him, why you have never asked? See, you have helped so much. No, suddenly they've changed. You should have at least asked, no, what happened? Why are you like this? And he's like, see, there is no use. They should only get that from within themselves. They should introspect themselves as a human. They should feel from inside, this man has done so much for me. But since they have chosen to ignore me, it means that they don't respect me. It is because they have used me. So I asked, have you shared all these with anybody? So he says, anything I have, I share only with wife. I don't forget things easily. Then, I asked him, what are the things that make him angry? I asked him to describe more about himself. Then he says, he's someone who gets irritated very easily. If someone does something against my wish, it is given out spontaneously. Means anger, he'll just tell directly. At that instant, he'll shout or he will raise his voice. Immediately, he'll cool down. If I'm right, I can express my anger to my boss also. So I asked him, is it because it's a government job and they can't remove you? Is it because of that means you have job security? So because of that, you're able to boldly express. So he says, I know it's a government job. They can't trouble me without any strong reason. But even then, if it's my fault, I will listen. If it's not my fault, I'm not afraid. If I'm right, I'm right. So he said this thing. If my self-respect is getting hurt, I cannot accept it. I can't hurt myself morally. I'm a man of principles. So if my respect is getting hurt, I don't mind quitting the government job also and working for private sector. But I won't compromise on my respect. Then he spoke about his marriage. He said it was a love-come arranged marriage. His wife is his aunt's neighbor. Nobody in the family knows except her mother that we were in a relationship. I somehow faced all the obstacles and made it look like it was arranged. So even till date, nobody knows in the family that they were in a relationship. He has made it seem like it's an arranged marriage, like somehow through Pandit or someone, he bribed someone and he made sure that her proposal comes to him. So I asked him, are you like this in other situations also? Like you can get things done your way. So he's like, if it is morally right, I'll get things done my way somehow. But if it is not morally right, I won't go for it. He was good at studies. He would study by himself. Nobody has to tell him to study. Up to 10th standard, I was a first ranker. Subjects which I enjoy, I used to study on my own. For other subjects, I need a push. Even in graduation, I got first. I was very particular about being first or second. Only in PSC, I got second division due to some board problems. I felt very bad. What will people think? Everyone knew I was a good student. What would be of my image? He was worried so much about his image. Actually, he had got good marks only. Only thing is that he didn't get as much as he expected. So he was so disappointed that he didn't get what he expected. He thought of rewriting the exam. Then I asked, why you want to rewrite? Many people, if they feel that if they pass, it's enough. No, why did you want to rewrite? So he's like, mera record kharab ho jayega. Means, all these years, I had a very good academic record. Because of this one PUC ka marks, my record is going to get spoiled. Many people had blind faith on me that I would do well. I disappointed them. And he was never interested in sports. I avoid physical work. I'm lazy for physical work. No stage fear. I can face crowd easily. I attract crowd easily. Initially, there would be slight anxiety. And I used to shake. I used to be nervous a bit. But once I begin, there is no issue. My left hand is stronger, but eating and writing is from right hand. If someone is showing attitude, I would maintain my distance. I would never go and butter someone. If I feel someone is overacting, I will withdraw. I'll cut off. Even if my worst enemy is coming to my house, I will treat them with a lot of respect. And when I examined his palms and soles, there was a lot of warmth of palms and soles. And he said that it is always like that. So there's a long case. Your inputs. Yeah, respect want of image conscious, Dr. Sophia. Yeah, Dr. Sushma says, sensitive to loud noise, delusion, feeling of being neglected, need respect, social position want of, yes, sympathetic, what else? Forsaken feeling, okay, what else? Why forsaken feeling, Dr. Pragati?
He is abandoned.
Okay.
With his friends, so that.
Okay, but actually, when I asked him, he kept saying that in both those situations, he felt that he did not get the respect that he deserved. See, what he basically wanted is, I have helped them so much; they should remember that I have helped them. Maine itna kiya, wo yaad rakhna chahiye. That is what he kept saying. It's not that he was missing them or anything. He felt that I have done so much. Even then, they don't have any gratitude for me. They don't respect me. That's what he felt. Wounded honor. Dr. Devika, yes. Yeah, he wants recognition or appreciation from Dr. Annapurna. Yeah. So that is what I felt was recurring throughout the history. Everywhere he's talking about his respect. Even when the marks issue came, that's what he felt. You know, I had an image. People had so much expectations from me, and I have disappointed them. My record has got spoiled. Means people knew me for something, and that got spoiled. Yeah, throughout the history, yeah, he keeps thinking about past incidences of disrespect, Dr. Sushma. Yeah, everywhere for him, his respect is all. More important than anything else. So I took the rubric lamenting because he is not appreciated. This was the rubric I took. Is it apt for this situation, for this case? Yeah. So lamenting actually means to express grief with a lot of passion. So throughout his history, what I felt was about not getting respect. That is the only thing that he kept saying throughout, and he really feels so bad for that. Even past incidences where he felt that his respect got affected, even about that till date, he is feeling so bad. So I took this rubric, lamenting because he is not appreciated. This was the only rubric I had taken for this case. And calcareous self and MMLS were coming up. So which would be the apt remedy for this case? No, only two remedies are coming up. Calcareous self and MMLS. Yeah, Dr. Pragati says calcareous self was the remedy which I gave. So calcareous self I prescribed on 22nd June. And he came back on 30th. No episode of pain or heaviness in the right lumbar region in the last 2 weeks. No fresh complaints, all general good. So I gave him placebo again. So in December 17th he came. He said no pain at all, no complaints at all. And again, when he came on 17th, he again complained of the same thing. That once while passing urine, he felt some mild heaviness in right loin region. And after that, he feels that he was quite sure that the stone would have passed off with the urine. So I asked him to get a USG done. And this was his USG, which was done on 11th January. It's a normal study. Both the kidneys were, good question, Dr. Sushma. She is asking, calcareous self was given before also. I checked with, it was given when he came first time, right? When he came in a severe episode, I'd given him calcareous self before lachesis. But that time it did not work. And I checked with VK sir also. So he told that maybe because he was in such an acute state, he required an acute prescription at that time for his state. So disposition prescription did not work. Constitutional prescription did not work in that case. That is what I learned from this case, that we cannot give a constitutional prescription for all types of conditions. There are some conditions in which you'll have to give a state prescription. And in this case, lachesis helped him in acute state. Actually, if you see lachesis and calcareous self, they are both related remedies. They're very similar to each other. So when I had selected this rubric and when I was giving calcareous self also, I was very confident that this time he would definitely improve with calcareous self. Because from Dr. Harsha's lecture also, what can suppress you? Only those remedies can suppress which are similar to the actual remedy. So I was very sure that calcareous self will work in this case this time. Yeah. That's about this case. Coming to the last case, it's a case of hypothyroidism. This is from college, Government Homeopathic Medical College. So she's a 26-year-old lady, married since 5 years. I took her case on 3rd December 2019. Education. She has done a diploma in commercial practice. And before marriage, she had worked for 1 year as a store manager. And she is a known case of hypothyroidism since 5 years. So I asked her how her hypothyroidism got detected, because she has absolutely no symptoms of thyroid. So she told that in the first trimester of first pregnancy, she had a miscarriage. And so when the gynec was trying to find out the cause of miscarriage, she was diagnosed as a case of hypothyroidism. And she was started off with Eltroxin, 50 mcg, OD for 6 months. After that, she discontinued Eltroxin and she started with homeopathic medicine. So So when she had, I took her case on 3rd December, she had already gotten her investigations done. As on 1st December, her TSH was 19.52. Like I already described, she had absolutely no symptoms of thyroid. Yeah, past history, there was a, that which I already mentioned. First pregnancy was a miscarriage. Second pregnancy was a C-section because of insufficient labor pains. No significant history in from family history. Personal history, appetite is good. She cannot tolerate hunger. And this is since childhood. She feels uneasy in abdomen. And she likes sweets. Thirst is not so much. Thermals, earlier she was hot. And presently she's chilly. Nothing significant from eliminations. Sleep is sound. Dreams, nothing significant. Tight clothing, she dislikes. It causes irritation. Coming to mind, at home, it is patient, husband, her son, and husband's aunt. And I asked her to describe about her nature. She says she's very silent since childhood. She takes time to mingle. And she doesn't like getting close to people. She's not very fond of people. She has some 4 or 5 friends from school and college days. And she's not very much in touch with them, but yeah, she's maintained the friendship. And she says, whoever is close, I'm very expressive only with them. I get angry when things don't happen my way, but I express my anger only with husband and mother. I asked her about her childhood. She says she has a younger sister. Compared to her, her younger sister is more outgoing and more expressive. Joru is the word that she used to describe her sister. So I asked her what that means, and she says sister speaks her mind out, and she was sharper. She's very smart. She was better at studies. Patient would study every day, but she says that as my memory was not good, I used to lose marks. And most of the time, sister would initiate fights, and I would usually compromise. And she had a very good equation with her parents. Yeah. So I asked her what she's sensitive to. She says she feels bad if things don't happen according to her wish. Either she'll become silent and refuse to speak, or she'll weep. And she weeps only when she's alone. I don't like crying in front of others. I don't want to show. Means I don't want others to see my tears. Ambition. I have always wanted to start a business of my own. My father was into financial troubles. He worked very hard to give us a good life, a good education. My parents never shared any problems with us, but we sensed and we felt that we should work hard and we should come up in life. I pursued accounts with the idea of starting a business, but I lost interest in studies because in spite of putting in enough efforts, I'm not getting good the required marks because of my memory issues. Later, I just wanted to do a job and I got one, but I quit after marriage. Hobbies, TV, she likes reading short stories, and she likes listening to melodies. And she has a strong fear of darkness since childhood. Even till date, in pitch darkness, she gets palpitations. So, I tried to ask her if she has any stress as such. So she was telling at present she does not have any stress. And since her thyroid had started since 5 years, I asked if there was any tension or anything around that time. So she says that it started after her marriage. It was an arranged marriage. Initial 2 years were very bad. There was not much of understanding between me and my husband. A lot of difference in our thinking. So I was very much attached to him. I liked him too much. But he was very critical. He wanted too much perfection. He wanted too much focus on cleanliness, neatness at home. All the household work should be very perfect. I was not like that. And he used to scold very harshly when I won't do things according to him. So I asked her what she felt. She says, I would feel very hurt. Tumba bejar aagtittu. I didn't know he was like this. I didn't know he was this harsh. We used to speak before marriage, like between the engagement and wedding, there was some time gap. So munche ella chenagittalla, munche chenagidvalla, yaak ee tara agide, ee tara agoyittalla. This was her reaction. I used to fight back with husband, But later, he would not speak to me for a long time out of anger. I used to feel very hurt, would feel like I'm alone, very lonely, no one to share with. So I used to compromise with him, not wholeheartedly. Nanu ishtella maadbeku, nane compromise maadbeku. Means she used to compromise in the fights because she used to feel lonely as husband would stop talking to her during the fights. Husband was very old school, means he was very traditional and conservative. My views are of this generation. He studied in government school, so his thinking was like that. I used to feel why he's like this. He's from this generation only, know why he can't think like this. The fights became too much between us, especially because of other people's interference. I asked her, who are those other people? Then she said, my mother-in-law used to interfere a lot. She'd tell something to him behind our back. I used to feel that she used to instigate the fights between us. She didn't want him to get married to me. From beginning only she had a problem with me, as she didn't like my family. During pregnancy, the problems between me and my husband became very severe. This, she's talking about the second pregnancy. First pregnancy, she suffered a miscarriage. So during second pregnancy, the problems became much worse. Became so bad that parents from both the families got involved and my parents took me home, as my my child should not get affected. During that time, my husband would not come to see me. He would never ask about my health or about my baby's health or talk to me. He used to always fight with me over phone. I felt very hurt. Why is he behaving like this? I felt like dying. Once I attempted also. But several times I used to feel that maybe I should have only compromised. If I would have compromised, problem would not have become so big. And then my mother-in-law attempted to get him married to someone else. But he took a stand for me. He said he won't marry anyone else. After that, gradually she said, after the pregnancy, things have started improving. But still she feels sometimes that she should have compromised and things would not have gone out of proportion. So this was all the history that she gave. What could be your analysis of this case?
Death desire.
Death desire, yeah. Somebody has, yeah. Suicidal disposition, Dr. Pragati, yes. Reproaching self. Sensitive to rudeness. Yeah. I took suicidal disposition in this case rather than death desire because she has attempted to commit suicide once. So I took suicidal disposition and had taken reproaching self because she kept blaming herself. Like she felt that if I would have compromised, things would have been better. So these two rubrics I had taken and forsaken feeling I have taken because she mentioned, right, that she used to feel very lonely and there is no one. And the last rubric that I've taken is a physical general rubric, that is hunger aggravation. I took this rubric because it is there since childhood. Like since her childhood, she cannot tolerate hunger. This was my repertorization. So we have anacardium, aurum, elevorus, lyco, silica, sulfur, and venoglu. Which could be the remedy that would be appropriate for her based on her disposition? Aurum, okay. Aurum. Yeah. I, based on her past disposition, I gave her lyco. Because she was hardworking, but I felt that if it was a metal, no, she would have not given up. Like everywhere she would get some difficulty. Like she said, I was putting in efforts but was not getting enough marks because of memory issues. So she lost interest in studies. Even job also, initially she was very enthusiastic about doing. Afterwards, after getting the job, she lost interest in job also. So I felt more than a metal, it would be, I felt it would not be a metal. So I gave her lyco Lyco 201 dose I have given in first week of December. And she came back, since she stays far, she came back after 2 months with her reports. I told her to get her thyroid TSH levels done after 2 months. And she's come back on 1st March and her TSH is within normal, limits, 1.75. So why in this case I felt very happy was because this was my first thyroid case without any thyroid medication. Like she was not on any allopathic medicines. Only with our medicine, single dose, her TSH level has come down to normal. That's all. This was the last case. Any questions, any doubts? So if we can wrap up today's session. So since we have come down to the end of today's presentation, I just want to thank Dr. Sufia is asking, should we consider fear of darkness? She used to develop palpitations. Yeah, we can consider that. We can consider that, but in this case, because I got two syphilitic rubrics, that is suicidal disposition and reproaching self, I didn't give much importance to the fears. But Lyco would definitely cover fear of darkness. Any other questions? Okay, so since there are no more questions, I think we can wrap up today's session. I just want to thank a few people. I want to thank Dr. Manohar sir for giving me this opportunity. And Dr. Harsha for encouraging me so much. Like he gave me a lot of tips on how to present and everything. And yeah, most importantly, my teacher, because of him, I am a practitioner today. Whatever I've learned, everything that I am today is because of sir. So a lot of heartfelt thanks to my teacher, Dr. Vijay Krishna sir. And one more person I want to thank is Dr. Nishan Gandhi. I had an opportunity to learn with him for 6 months. And a lot of my repertorization, how my approach to cases, a lot of those things I've learned from him. The confidence to practice or to set up a practice, I got mainly because of my experience from him. So yeah, thank you everyone.